Kwubiri. I was born in Nigeria, grew up in the Bronx, and I'm currently the Director of Global Business Services, Change Management at MTV.
Usually I start out my interviews asking people what their last 9-to-5 is. You sort of kind of have a 9-to-5, but not really. So tell us a little bit about your quote-unquote 9-to-5.
Okay, yeah. So I actually came from more of a traditional 9-to-5 where I worked at PricewaterhouseCoopers as an accounting firm. My background's in accounting. And then moved over to MTV, which is nothing as a 9-to-5 at all. So my schedule just changes. Some days I'm in the office at 10, some days at noon, sometimes I leave at 3, sometimes I'm here till 7. So it really just varies and depends on what the task is for the day, but that's what I like about it. I also have the opportunity to work from home at times because in my role, I'm supporting a lot of the brands and the companies globally. So that's why it's a very non-traditional 9-to-5. You just kind of have to like work with it, whatever the need is.
So far, I've interviewed a lot of entrepreneurs about being successful, the grind and everything like that. But you are successful in your field, you know, even without working for yourself. So tell us a little bit about what it is that you do here at MTV and how you're successful at your job.
How am I successful at my job? Well, I think that I am a go-getter. So whether it was at MTV or any other company, I'll probably be trying to reach for the top because that's my personality. And if I didn't think that I was a good fit there, I'll probably be leaving and trying to do something else. So here at MTV, again, I'm in Global Business Services, Change Management. So I support the office for anything that's related to a new change. So if we think about, let's say, a perfect example is like the airline industry and when they started charging for check bags. So my job is to come up with a strategy on how we implement the check baggage fees. And then how to communicate it to people, how to get people on board with it, how to decrease any of the risk as like people going to other airlines and things like that. So I really manage change within the organization. And what I love most about it too is that I get to work across all of the brands and all the offices. So even though we keep saying MTV, it's really Viacom Media Networks because I work across any of the channels, so MTV, BET, VH1, and any of the brands. A lot of times I think people ask me about like, do I want to be an entrepreneur? Or do I consider myself an entrepreneur? So not in the actual definition sense of entrepreneurship, but I am an entrepreneur in my own career. I am one of those people that I don't mind corporate America. I see myself being a CEO one day or a COO one day and using my skills to support other people that are true entrepreneurs and are governing their own company. So I think that you could be an entrepreneur and still work for a regular company.
You graduated from Howard University, which is like a mecca of entrepreneurs. Like that's the birthplace of a lot of entrepreneurs. When you were in school, did you ever feel at that time that you wanted to be a business owner?
Yes, Howard. Go if you have kids, send them. If you're going back to school, go. I love Howard, and it's something about being on that campus and the type of like legacy and confidence that they build in you, like 1000%. So I was in the School of Business, and in the School of Business, it's all about entrepreneurship and growing in a company. So you, and then you know, you hear about the people that have gone to Howard, and some of them are head of companies or in charge of their own company. So entrepreneurship, I think, was big overall. And then you have like the students where, you know, they did like hair braiding in the class in the dorms and things like that. So the concept of entrepreneurship was always there and definitely always instilled at Howard. So as far as the pressures, freshman year, I did have to come up with a full business plan. Wow. That was the requirement for being in the School of Business. We had to work in teams. We had case studies. So entrepreneurship was instilled in you very, at the very beginning. But again, I think that it's instilled in you so that you can able to use those skills to also bring it to a company. So, or being an entrepreneur of your own career. And really that means managing and being in control of it, right? So you are the person that's speaking things into existence and you're the one that's doing things. So I credit Howard for many of the accomplishments that I have, and I always try to go back to the university and give back to the students as much as I can or to share my story with them because they were definitely influential in my career today.
When you graduated, you well, since you've graduated, you've landed jobs with top companies, like across the board, from MTV, from Pricewaterhouse, you've landed these jobs. So I know that you are an expert at, you know, putting in the application and getting the interview and getting the job. So do you have any tips for anyone who is looking to, you know, get past all of the other applicants and land the job, that dream job?
Yes, listen, I would say it's, you know, I've been at MTV now for 9 years, so it has been a minute since I've actually, like, applied for a job. But funny thing is, even though I'm not applying for jobs, I still get job opportunities that come my way. Mm-hmm. And I think that the important thing is putting yourself out there. You know, always just surface and see what's going on. Keep that resume updated. And I think that what I would like to say sometimes sets me apart is I kind of walk in with a lot of confidence. You know, some people may be like, oh, she's cocky. It's not cocky at all. Like, I think you have to come in owning it. You have to come in like, this is my job. This is my position. This is why I deserve to be here. Really understanding your network and really understanding what you can bring to a company, but also keep it in mind of how you can grow, right? So really trying to go in there. I think that I did have an interview not too long ago, and they asked me a few questions, and I told them my story, and I told them, listen, this is why I think that I should work for your company. This is why I think that you would need me, and this is why my experience will yield to your company. And I think that that was impressive to them, and they saw that confidence in what I was saying. And another thing too, like, as I'm growing in my career, a lot of things is not really about your book knowledge. It's really about how you work with other people and how you're able to connect and network. It's really coming into a room and feeling comfortable. One of the executive vice presidents here, she asked me to go on a project in Italy before. And I asked her, I was like, oh, you know, just curious, why did you ask me? And I always ask people that, like when people find out about me or things like that, I always like, oh, why me?
That's a good question.
Yeah, so that because it helps you internally try to understand like what is working and then what you need to change. And she said, you have a very common spirit. She was like, I know that you're gonna get it done, and you're gonna get it done in a way where people around you won't feel frustrated. So now I use that to my advantage and to try to show that when I'm interviewing with people, when I'm networking or whatever I'm doing, that I have a good team spirit, that you can put me in the room with almost anyone. Here, I work a lot of with the executive suite, so with the CFOs and the CEOs and things like that. So I'm in meetings with like really high people, but then I'm also in meetings with interns, you know, and I think that that is what you need to show. You need to show like how can you relate to someone else, regardless of the position you hold, regardless of the education you may have, and regardless of the experience you may have as well.
You went from working for the accounting firm to now MTV, which is totally different when it comes to the environment, the work environment. Tell me some of the challenges you had when it came to adjusting.
Yeah, so today I have on jeans that are ripped. So could not wear that at my previous job at all. And I think that one of the challenge is I had to, MTV is very creative driven. And I came from such a corporate foundation, and even at Howard too, like in the School of Business, we had to wear suits our freshman year to our School of Business classes. And everyone used to always like, oh, she's in the School of Business, she has on a suit. And I had to be like a black suit or a gray one. So, and that helped with my first job because they were very corporate. So then when I came here, I really had to loosen up a little bit. I think I'm overall friendly, but I think when I come to work, I try to keep a demeanor of being very professional. I think here, I have to kind of like calm it down a little bit and show that I'm spunky and I can get with the creative side, but also bring my core foundation, which I think is why I was hired actually, because I was coming from a very traditional background and they wanted someone to bring on that change into the finance organization. So I would probably say another thing is adjusting to the time differences. So just like, I remember one time I was here, like my first summer, people were here in like t-shirts and shorts and rolling up at 12. And I'm like, what is going on? But you just adjust with it. You just have to show, again, I think I was saying it before, like that you can adapt and you can connect with people that may not look like or act like you. So it was definitely different.
You travel a lot for this company. Was that an initial requirement when you first started?
No, it was not an initial requirement when I first started to travel. I think the only thing that they really told me was we work across all brands. And when I first started, I really didn't know what that meant. I'm like, oh yeah, yeah, you know, I watch MTV, I watch BET, VH1, okay. But soon I learned very quickly, as like I think my first few weeks we were off to LA, like to help out. If anyone remembers Pimp My Ride, that was my first production. got to meet Exhibit, so that was cool. So I was like, oh, this place is kind of cool. Okay. So yeah, so I didn't know about that travel piece at all. And I think that over the years, it kind of just evolved. I don't think it was in the job description. Even if they write the job description today, they probably only say that it's 10% travel, but I probably travel 60% of the time, you know, maybe 70%. And I think it comes with the fact that I just get assigned different projects that require me to travel, again, because of my superiors know what I can bring to the table and they know that I can deliver. So it's been a joyous ride traveling these places and getting to know about the other businesses that we do and everything.
You say you travel 70% of the time for work. And people look at your social media, they see you traveling all these beautiful places, but that's a lot to be traveling. So tell us a little bit about things that people may not see or may not know about traveling, you know, for your job. That's not so pretty.
Yeah, my boyfriend tells me to sit down. I wonder if it really is 70%. It's a lot. Like, it's a lot. I'm not gonna lie. It's a lot. The last 2 years especially, I think, has been like crazy. I think that what people need to understand is when you travel for work, you're actually doing more work. You know, I can be gone a week, 2 weeks, but in this 2 weeks, I have to get so much done. So again, I think we were talking about that 9 to 5. That doesn't exist when I'm traveling. Like, I am up, I am answering emails, I'm answering calls, getting ready to get into the office. Once I'm in the office, boom, it's ongoing. Like, you barely have time to really even walk away to have a decent lunch or anything like that, especially if you're in a different time zone, which most of the time I am. So then what happens is that day may end, let's say it's ending about like 6 o'clock, but then your New York office is up, so now they have questions for you to answer too. Then, okay, you think you're wrapping up with New York, but then the LA office is now up, so they're asking you questions too. So it's so much about time management and really taking care of yourself, because you don't want to be working and you're sick, so that's another thing too. But it, all that glitters is not gold. It's a lot of work. Sometimes you do get homesick. I have, what do they call FOMO all the time, like fear of missing out. I'd be like, Dad, another event? Can you push that till next week? Like, yeah, or like sometimes my friends try not to invite me to stuff anymore if they're shady. And I'm like, you need to still invite me because I can try to make it work. But so sometimes you miss those things. You miss like a home cooked meal, even though you're like in a really nice hotel. Sometimes you miss being in your bed. And those are the little things that you just have to kind of like push through and count down. But it's really been rewarding because, one, I got to go to places that I probably never even had on my list to even go to. I just came back from Singapore, and we talk a lot about like Asia or that side of the world, but we talk about like Bali and Thailand, but going to Singapore was amazing. Like, it was a great experience, and I would have never went just because I just wasn't thinking about it. So I do try to find the time to explore the city as much as I can, and I think it's helped me creatively in my career because I'm able to connect with people from different cultures and really understand like how business is done somewhere else. And it's so funny to see like the urgency that we have in the US and especially in New York, and it doesn't really exist in other places, but those people are still very much successful. So, you know, and you know, I know like in some countries maternity leave is like 1 year and it's paid, and it's just like, oh my God. So it's really had me to open my eyes. So now I think anywhere I go, I'm always going to be looking for like the global aspect of that company. Like, I think I was talking to this lady the other day, and I'm just like, oh, do you guys have like a global office? Are you thinking about one? Like, now I don't want to travel 70% of the time anymore, but to be able to at least 10% of the time be able to go to another office and kind of support them, I think is really rewarding in your career.
You mentioned having time management skills in order to successfully travel and work and do all of those things. Do you have any tips or apps or anything that you use in order to, you know, make good use of your time?
Yes, yes. I'm obsessed with my calendar. Like, I put everything on my calendar. I put my hair appointments in there. I put calling someone, emailing someone. If it's not on my calendar, like, seriously, it doesn't exist. Because sometimes you get so many emails and you so many follow-ups, I'm like, I don't know. You know, so all those things get lost. So I literally calendar everything. And now what I started doing is calendaring on, because I just use like Google Calendar, and I started putting it on my work calendar as well. Because again, since I'm supporting so many offices internationally, they may think I'm available, but I have like a personal thing to do on my personal calendar. So I need to block that time off on my work calendar as well. So I think that that's one of the, I think just my calendar alone, and my friends laugh at me, but on my phone, I have actually, oh, this is only 12:30, but on my phone is actually military time because that just helps me be able to know like what the time is, other places that I go to. And on my clock, I also have a lot of the countries that I visit often, and I have their time on there too, because I need to know the time difference, and then we have daylight savings, some countries don't. So 1 month it could be 5 hours, and next month is four hour time difference. So that's probably the three things, is my clock, my military time, and my calendar.
As busy as you are, you still find time to help and support other people, other organizations. I know you work with two nonprofit organizations, as well as you're helping Tiffany from the workplace, you know, with her blog. How do you find time to still help other people, and how important is that for you?
Shout out to the workplace. I really, philanthropy is big to me. I am a member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, and we live on service, like service and commitment, that's what we do. And I think that is important to all of us that have special skills, whether you are a videographer, if you are a skilled interviewer, if you're in the finance industry, to be able to give back as much as you can. You know, there are a lot of young kids out there that are not exposed to these things, and we need to show them. We need to show them that you can do great things. We need to show them that your circumstance is not your future. And I think that that's why it's important to me, even if it's just me just getting a conference call to try to advise someone that's starting a nonprofit, which is what I did with She's the First. I used to be on their board as their treasurer, and I literally helped them from the bottom up to start up bank accounts and to start an accounting process and how to manage their funds and do their budgeting, to supporting Girls with Gifts, where I help out with their annual bowling tournament that they have to raise money for young girls. So I think it's you owe it to your community to give back. So whatever that looks like for you, you know, everyone cannot volunteer and meet up with a mentee every single week. I get it, you know, but maybe you can participate in a toy drive. Maybe you can go to a school. Maybe you can show a kid in your neighborhood how to use a video camera. You know, so those are the things, and I think it's very, very important to me for young girls, especially young girls, to be able to see that you can be bigger than what society thinks that you can be, and there are positive role models out there that are cute, fly, hip, and still making money and doing great things, and you know, and I think that's my mission, and I love the fact that I can get to do that, and they call me and like, oh, look what I did, and it's cute, and you're able to really see them grow and try to work with them in a very unconditional and unjudgmental type of way, because I think that they need that too. So
a lot of times when people land their dream job, they're like, I'm staying here forever, I'm planting my feet, I'm not going anywhere, the retirement package is great, I'm never going anywhere. But I know that you're not that type of person, right? So tell me, what plans do you have to get to the next level for yourself, for your career, you know, personally and professionally?
Yeah. It's so funny because it's like, I've been here 9 years. I'm like, what? What
this 9 years of bliss. I've been traveling, you've been doing a lot.
What are you doing with yourself? I am, and it's funny that I'm in change management because I'm all about change. Like, I'm all about what's next. Like, what is the next thing to do? How can I grow? I'm always trying to like evolve and learn something new and learn something about myself. And I think my experience here has been awesome. And I think that what has really kept me here though is my role kept evolving. And I think my boss will probably laugh and she'll tell you like, Ezinne, oh yeah, she comes to my office all the time and she always wants to know like, what's the next project we're working on? And she always takes a lot of initiative. That's who I am. Like that's in my blood. And I think for now, like this is kind of where it is. And I'm trying to do other things on the side and seeing where I can grow and how I can leverage my skills to support other activities and things like that. But I will be honest and say, like, my goal is to definitely be at the top. Like, it's to be the COO or the CEO of a company, completely running it and being a top executive. That's where I've always seen myself to be. So we'll see if that is at MTV or if I need to go elsewhere and then maybe even come back. But I definitely will say, though, I am interested in staying in this entertainment and fashion type of beauty industry. So still a very untraditional type of role and kind of seeing like how I can grow from there using all of those skills. And to be in an international market would be great as well. So we'll see what happens in the next 2, 5, 10, 15 years.
If people want to keep up with you, how can they find you? Where can they find you?
Yep, you can go on my website. That's probably the first and best place to go. It's just-ezzi.com. And I try to keep a lot of my information up there and different events that I'm going to, especially if they're public events. And, or you can catch me at Instagram, which is at IamEzzi, or on Facebook as well, which is just my name. So I thank everyone for the feedback, and I really love this opportunity, and it's so great to be able to share my story. And even, I would never have pictured this in a million years. I really just try to be me and try to be as authentic as possible. And it's good to kind of see that that reward is coming full force. So I'm happy to see like what happens in the next few years.